Welcome to Vandana's biology class, children. Today we will be dealing with some interesting topic of your syllabus. Okay, see the picture here. It shows what is called rolling of tongue. Some of us can do it and some of us cannot do it, isn't it? Now here you are able to see what is called as hitchhiker's thumb. Some people can bend their thumb like this and some people cannot, isn't it? Here you are able to see the normal hairline, isn't it? And in this picture you are able to see small differences, isn't it? So this kind of hairline is called widow's peak. So some people will have it like this also. Now here you are able to see attached earlobes. Some people have attached earlobes like this and some people have free earlobes like this, isn't it? So you are seeing several traits or characters in these pictures, isn't it? So today we are going to discuss with Mendel's laws, dominance, segregation, independent assortment, which are a part of genetics, the second unit and the first chapter and the second unit. Okay, so what is inheritance? Transfer of characters from parents to offsprings is called inheritance. One gene is responsible for expressing different characters or number of genes. Expresses one character. Okay, one gene is responsible for expressing different characters or number of genes expresses one character. All these are there. Whatever it is, genes are the basic unit of inheritance. Okay, now coming to what is genetics. It's a branch of biology that deals with the study of inheritance and variation of characters from parent to offspring. Okay, so this branch of biology is called genetics. And Mendel was the first person to study genetics, so he is called as the father of genetics. So this is the picture of Johann Gregor Mendel. So transfer of characters from parent to their offspring is called heredity. Okay, so inheritance is the base of heredity. And when the characters are being transferred from the parent to offspring, there is a small difference that is coming up, isn't it? So the differences account to what is called as variation. Okay, and variation form the raw material of evolution. So here you are able to see different children, isn't it? It's like difference in their skin colors, isn't it? So this is what we mean by variation. Okay, now so Darwin's finches, here I'm mentioning taking the name of Darwin, which we will come across. Darwin's finches we will be studying in the later chapters. But Darwin's finches, why am I mentioning these? These are birds which were existing in Galapagos Island, and from there they have migrated to different parts and they have changed their beak pattern. Okay, so there is a modification in their beak patterns here, and this is accounting to what is called as evolution. This differences or what we call as variation has led to what is called as evolution. So here also you are able to see the difference in the colors, isn't it? So this is what is called as variation. Now Mendel, why is he called as father of genetics first of all, isn't it? So Mendel performed experiments on garden pea, that is Pisum sativa. Okay, he was much interested. He belonged to a peasant family. Then he was not a very good student, but he was very curious. Okay, that kind of a child he was. So as he grew up, he was given some religious education and he was sent to monastery, and surrounding the monastery there were so many people, and so he got a lot of interest in these. And he selected Pisum sativa because flowers of pea are hermaphrodites, that is bisexual. Okay, they are capable of self-fertilizing. Okay, and he observed a lot of different traits. Okay, which are easily seen morphologically, means color, shape, is this kind of things. Okay, so cross pollination could be achieved easily. Okay, it is an annual, isn't it? So within 1 year, one season, its life cycle is over. So it was easy for him, and he observed some 7 pairs of contrasting traits like this. So see the position of the flower, the height of the stem, the shape of the seed. Okay, the color of the seed. Okay, see the color of the pod and the shape of the pod and the color of the flower. All these are visible characters. So he has selected visible characters for his experiments. See, like this. tall, dwarf, round, wrinkled. Okay, I made you write these in your classwork also. So just have a look at this particular one, isn't it? Slide. And just note down the contrasting traits. And here, understand that we are representing each and every trait with a particular alphabet. And I am mentioning capital and small, isn't it? So capital letters are for the dominant trait, and the lowercase which we use conventionally, we use for the recessive traits. Okay. So again, the same one. Yeah. Here is a table. This table is also there in your textbook, isn't it? So actually, he took up two breeding plants. Okay. For generations, he left them for self-pollination, and then he observed that simply it is either true, breeding tall or dwarf. Okay. So it is giving rise to progeny which is tall. A particular plant is tall and is giving rise to all tall plants, and a plant is dwarf is giving rise to all dwarf plants. So he took such plants. Okay. And he took up around 14 true breeding pea plant varieties and performed experiments. Okay, so between 1856 to 1863, he conducted experiments, and he just counted the number of plants which are tall, dwarf, like this, whenever he did. And he generalized these into simple ratios and gave numbers. And from his experiments, he concluded that there are some factors that are controlling the characters, okay? And these factors are occurring in pairs, and some of the characters are continuously expressing and some of them are getting hidden, and they skip generations and express in the next generations. So the character which is expressing in all the generations, he called it as a dominant one, and the other which is skipping generations or which is hidden in some generations, he called it as recessive. Okay. So he, when he did experiments, selected pea plants that are differing in one particular character. So that was called as a monohybrid cross. We call it as monohybrid cross. Okay. So here homozygous means capital T or small t, that is pure tall, pure dwarf. Heterozygous means capital T, small t. This is also tall because the dominant allele T is there. Okay. So phenotype is more about how it morphologically appears. So capital T, small t is phenotypically tall, okay, but genotypically it is heterozygous. Okay, so dominant one is getting expressed in the F1 generation, and recessive is hidden in F1 but expresses in the F2. So these are the terms which we use. Okay, so you see a short pea plant cross to tall pea plant, all are tall pea plants, so that is capital T small t wale hai ye. Okay, and then when these are self, do you get like this three tall is to one dwarf. Okay, so similarly, if you take purple and white, violet and white color flowers, also the same way it is happening. Okay, see, round and wrinkled. So round is dominant. Okay, so capital R small r is round, and in the F2 generation, you get one wrinkled, which is pure for the wrinkled trait. So when an F1 heterozygote is crossed to a recessive parent or an organism having recessive genotype, it is called test cross. Because if the genotype of an organism is unknown, then crossing it to the double recessive parent, okay, and if the progeny is 1:1, then the unknown can be called as heterozygote. So the name test cross comes from this. You are able to test something. Yeah. And now we are going to what is called as a checkerboard kind of a thing, isn't it? So this kind of representation, where you have got, see, purple and white. Okay, so if this is a test cross where we do not know the genotype of this, so upon crossing with the double recessive parent, suppose if this particular one is heterozygote, then you will get 1:1 segregation, like the way where I'm pointing with the mouse. Okay, suppose if this unknown genotype is a dominant, double dominant purple, then all are purple. So based on the progeny, you can identify the genotype of the unknown organism. Okay, so this is an advantage with the test cross. Okay, so here also the same thing is shown. Okay, so based on the monohybrid cross, actually he could deduce two laws, the law of dominance and the law of segregation. Okay, So, what is law of dominance? When two individuals of a species differing in a pair of contrasting forms of a trait are crossed, then the form of the dominant trait that appears in the F1 hybrid is dominant. Okay, and the alternate form that remains hidden is recessive. So, you see, in this case, tall and dwarf. So, what is being hidden? Dwarf character is being hidden, so that is recessive. Where it is expressing? It is expressing in the F2 generation, isn't it? Right? So, what is law of segregation telling? So, if there are two factors controlling, okay, then this particular factor is getting replaced by the term gene. So, if there are a pair of alleles controlling a particular character, then these pair out of these pair, each they segregate. Segregate means they separate. During gamete formation, and only one of the factors enters a gamete. So, you see here, when we are trying to represent it. So, guinea pigs, black and brown coat color. Okay. So, this is pure for the trait and that is pure for the brown trait. So, they are segregating. So, the gamete is receiving one of these two. So, here, the guinea pig here is a, heterozygous one, but it is still black. So, you are getting like this. Okay. So, this is what we mean by segregation. The gamete will receive one of the two alleles. So that's what. So when you go for the next generation, that is F2, so how it is happening, you see, so out of all the four, one is pure black, two are heterozygous black, and one is pure brown. Okay, so when we look into Mendel's dominance and segregation and these concepts, certain points we have to remember. A phenotype will not reveal the genotype. So, let us look here. So, when it is black here, it is pure black. Here it is heterozygous black, but phenotypically both are black, but genotypically they are different. So, the statement is a phenotype will not reveal the genotype. Brown fur is dominant in dogs. The dog is brown. Is it the homozygous or heterozygous for the trait? That is something which we cannot look at the dog and decide, isn't it? Now, mutation crossing over can sometimes mess up your predictions. Now, this comes when there is some linkage operating, two genes are there and so on. Then, crossing over can make it different. And suppose if it is a mutation coming up, then that can change the trait. Suddenly it will give a different color. Something can go wrong there. I mean, our assumptions will go wrong. Okay. Now, test crosses should be done with recessive organisms. Otherwise, cross with a dominant parent or an organism with such genotype is called only back cross. Okay. So here, how did Mendel arrive at this solution at this point? Because he just looked into certain concepts of probability. So if you look into tossing a coin, then the chance of getting head or tail is 50-50, isn't it? So, you just observe here. Same thing we are just representing here. Okay. So, if you have this kind of a table here. So, I am writing 50% head, 50% tail here, half and half. Here also half and half. So, you multiply it, you will get 1 by 4. So, this is similar, much similar to what we wrote here, isn't it? Okay. So, let us look into these assumptions here. And apply these to, human genetics. So, what is the chance that Mr. and Mrs. Nobody will have a girl at any point? 50%. It is either a girl or a boy. So, what is the chance of a girl? 50% only. Okay. Mr. and Mrs. Nobody want three children and they only want boys. What is the likelihood that this will occur? They want three children and all boys means half every issue, every chance 50-50, isn't it? 50% girl, 50% boy. So, every time this is happening means half into half into half, that is 1 by 8 or 0.125% chances that all three are boys. Okay. Then Mr. and Mrs. Nobody have two boys already. What is the chance the child Mrs. Nobody is pregnant with now will be a boy? It is again 50%, isn't it? Like this. So, you can apply this to human genetics also and a concept map. So, now let us look into Mendel's law of inheritance. If you are looking into one gene, he did actually experiments with one gene. He did experiments with two genes also. when it is an experiment with one gene, we call it as monohybrid process and all, and when it is with two, then it is dihybrid. Okay, then with monohybrid crosses, he gave two laws, law of dominance and law of segregation. When it is with two genes, he gave what is called as law of independent assortment. So he worked predominantly with Pisum sativum, and he gave his laws, he published his laws in a paper and he sent it to universities, but people did not really understand why numbers and mathematics are coming in what is called natural sciences. That time biology was called natural sciences. They didn't understand this, so they were much neglected. Okay, and they were rediscovered by three different scientists in 1900. So that is Correns, Dirys and Shermack. Dirys, Correns and Shermack rediscovered these laws when they were experimenting individually on some other organisms also, not exactly Pisum. So when people started experimenting with the Antirrhinum majors and Mirabilis jalapa and so many other organisms, animals and plants, they came across some exceptions which were different, giving different results, and did not give the Mendel's results rather, right? So incomplete dominance and codominance are two things which are not mentioned, or which Mendel did not come across and others have come across, and they give a different ratio. They don't give the 3:1 ratio of Mendel. Okay, and similarly linkage and recombination operate when two genes are considered, or so they give again a different result which is not Mendelian. So these are exceptions to Mendel's laws. So we are going to discuss more about incomplete dominance, codominance, linkage, recombination, all in the next session. Okay, so until then, thank you.